Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
I'm going to get down on my knees and let's go before the Lord together in prayer today. Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're grateful we can come into your house openly and freely, God. Lift our hearts and our hands to you, God. Thank you for those that were healed in the church service today, God. Thank you for the encouragements and the words that you've given to people. God, we could stop right there and be content, but Lord, we're not. We want to go further with you. We want to go farther, God. We want to hear your voice, and we want to follow your wisdom and your way for our lives, God. So Holy Spirit, be welcome in this place. Come and be our teacher, be our guide. As we open up your word, open it up to us and open us up to receive. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, and our hearts to have a good understanding. Come, Holy Spirit, be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction that we need for our lives, and we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we don't just ask this blessing on ourselves. Also, we'd ask it for all of our brothers and sisters in the Lord that are preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet. We love them, Lord, and we don't think of ourselves as any better than anybody else, but we see ourselves as co-workers and co-laborers together in your field, building one kingdom, that's yours. So God, we ask that you bless all the churches. God, bless our Baptist and Lutheran, Methodist, Episcopalian, Charismatic, Pentecostal brothers and sisters, Lord. Bless the Four Square denominations, the assemblies, God, for our Catholic and Adventist brothers and sisters, Lord. We thank you for Harvest in Oak Valley, for the Well and the Way, for Ecclesia, God, for Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, God. Too many churches to name by name, but Lord, if they're preaching your gospel, we bless them in the name of Jesus. Also, Lord, we pray for our persecuted brothers and sisters around the world that are suffering. God, we ask that you give them strength, that they endure, God, that you protect them, and may the gospel be fully preached by them to all nations, Lord. And as well, God, we lift up our nation, and we pray as the elections are coming up, God, that you would give us wise and godly leadership who will be able to have a heart after your heart, God, and direct this nation and our land in the ways of God. And we give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say,
amen.
Amen. You can have a seat, get your Bibles out, and go with me to the book of Hebrews, the 10th chapter, continuing our study in the book of Hebrews. If it's your first time, I forgot to do this, two services in a row, first time. If it's your first time, I want to say hi. I want to tell you that we love you a whole lot. Also, we have a little brochure we'd love to get into your hands. Can't get it to you until we know where you're at. So if that's you, would just lift up your hands and let us know that you're here for the first time. Welcome over there. Welcome on this side. Welcome up top over there. Glad to have you with us. Anybody else here for the first time? All right, up top. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Come on, let's give them a great big warm welcome. Yeah. If you haven't already got that brochure, just keep your hands up for a moment, wave at one of the ushers, they'll spot you and pass one of those down your direction. Just tuck it away. There's some basic information about The Rock. You can read about it later. There's a general information card that right after church service, you can take it to the right-hand side of the foyer as you exit and drop that off there, and we'll give you a free copy of today's message as well as get some refreshments into your hands, and we'd love to meet you in person. So we're thankful that you came today. Also want to welcome those of you that are online across the nation and around the world. Thanks for joining us. I believe God's going to speak to you right where you're at too. Hebrews, 10th chapter. All right, let me get there myself. Hebrews, the 10th chapter, starting in verse number 34. We're talking about the reward of confidence. Hebrews, the 10th chapter, the reward of confidence. Actually, it's verse number 35. Last time we were together, you remember we talked about verse number 34, and because we have an illuminated perspective, we've got a different outlook on life, got a different outlook on sufferings, on people, and we have an eternal perspective. Today, we continue in those thoughts in the 35th verse of Hebrews, the 10th chapter. It says these words. It says, therefore, in other words, because of what I just said, because you have a different mindset, because you have an eternal perspective and not an earthly perspective, therefore, do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward. In other words, he's exhorting them and encouraging them, church, I want you to hold on. I want you to not cast away your confidence. I don't want you to get rid of it. Why? Because it has great reward. Each and every one of us want that reward in our lives. We want to see the blessing of God poured out on us. We want to see those things that God has in store for us. But you're not going to get there if you cast away your confidence. Now, that word confidence is an interesting word. We've already talked about it many times throughout the book of Hebrews. It's the same word that you find in your Bible called boldness. You remember we studied this throughout the book of Hebrews. That we can boldly approach the throne of grace. We can find mercy and grace to help in a time of need. That we can be bold for God, that we can live a life that's open and frank and potent. We can have a life that is full strength. We can be bold for Jesus in every area of our life. We can boldly stand against the wiles of the enemy. We can boldly declare the word of the Lord over our life. We can boldly go and witness to somebody about Jesus. And therefore he says, do not cast away your confidence. Don't get rid of your boldness. Don't allow anything to stop you from being everything that you are. Don't compromise. Don't let up. Don't quit. Don't get off of it. Do not cast away your confidence. Why? Because it has great reward. Now, there's many factors that come against us, each and every one of us, on a regular basis to get us to cast away our confidence. See, if I have something on me, the only way to get it off of me is to get me distracted from it. For instance, I've got this coat on me right now. Now, nice blue coat, right? But if it started looking ratty to me, if I looked at it and said, well, you know, it's nice and all, but it's not that new anymore. You know, when I first got it, it was really cool. It was really special. But now I see it wears. And you start to get distracted. You start to get off of it. Maybe if it got really hot. And I said, you know what, this coat is great and all, but it's really hot and I'm really sweaty. I got to take this off of me. See, there can be distractions that come. Distractions come in many ways. How about this one? Persecutions. The heat is on. All of a sudden, our confidence, we're confident, we're going for Jesus, we're declaring the word, we're potent, we're bold, and yet now all of a sudden somebody says, sit down and shut up. You shouldn't be saying that. At the workplace, you're carrying your Bible to work and you set it there on your desk and somebody says, that's offensive, you should put that away, you should keep that at home. At lunch, you do your daily Bible study and somebody says, what are you doing? You're going to get fired for that. And all of a sudden, you've lost your boldness. Now you've gotten distracted and you've cast it away. You no longer bring your Bible. You now hide because of persecution. Distractions come in other forms. How about this? Delays in the process. Sometimes we get distracted by the delay in the process. What does that mean? That means I'm confessing the word of the Lord. I'm waiting on the Lord. I'm boldly declaring the word of God. And yet it tarries. It seems to just take too long. God, where are you? God, what are you doing? Lord, I've been asking you for prosperity, and I've been declaring that you take pleasure in the prosperity of your servant. God, I'm your servant. What's going on here? I've been speaking it for days and months, years, and yet I still haven't seen it. Now you've been believing for your healing. Day after day after day after day, you're declaring, by his stripes I was healed. By his stripes I was healed. By his stripes I was healed. And after months and months of declaring, you're not getting any better. See, sometimes delays in the process can get us, well, maybe God doesn't want me to be healed. Maybe God's mad at me. Maybe I'm in sin. I guess the Lord really didn't. God's got to be teaching me a lesson through this, and I just must be so stupid that I don't get it yet, so therefore I'm not going to get healed yet, and we get off of our confession. We get off of our boldness. See, the delays sometimes can get us off of what God has for us. How about this one? Deterrence. Deterrence. Maybe somebody is a well-meaning person. Maybe they love you. Maybe it's a relative or a friend. Could even be someone in church. Sometimes we have a problem because, you know, we were going for God and we thought we were doing the right thing and we were bold, and yet someone comes along and they say something with the best of intentions, and yet it deters us from being everything that God has called us to be. I remember when I was ministering in our young adults ministry years ago, I was given an altar call, and at the end of the altar call, you know, a couple of people got saved, and we had a great night, and I was feeling good about everything that God was doing there, and so I got down off the platform, I was greeting people, and a couple of guys came up, and they seemed friendly, seemed real nice, real put together, and they greeted me, and they said, hey, we're from such and such a church, and we love what you guys are doing here. Everything was great, the music, the message, it was awesome, but don't you think that you should use a little bit more love in your altar call? And it was almost as if that word just pierced me. It was like they cut me. They had the best of intentions, and that was the best that they knew, and they thought that they were helping me out when, in fact, they were deterring me from being bold for Jesus. Can I ask you a question? If my child was out in the street, and there was a car coming, and you saw me say, oh, honey, please, get out of the street. Come to Daddy. You would think, what's he doing? Right? No, if you saw me yelling at my kid, hey, get out of the street. You want to be a little pancakes and get over here, right? You'd say, that's a good dad, right? Loves his child enough to tell him the truth. See, sometimes those deterrents, no matter how well-intentioned, they can get us off of the things of God. Oh, that's a nice coat, but, you know, it's blue, and blue's not that great. Oh, well, you're right. And yet, we cast away our confidence all the time. See, if the devil can get you distracted, If the world systems can get you deterred, if delays can come and get you off, then eventually you will get discouraged and slump into a depression. See, we don't understand. Sometimes we think, I don't know what this is. There's just this cloud. There's this fog. I don't want to get up out of bed. I don't want to do anything. You know, I used to have this spark in my life. I used to have just this vibrant relationship with God. But now I don't know if God's here or not. I don't know what God is doing. And we get discouraged. And eventually we get depressed. Now all of a sudden, where we should have been out, we're in. Where we should have been up, we're down. Where we should have been the head, we're the tail. See, and yet God has said, I don't want you to live a life like that. I've not called you to shrink back. I've not called you to be discouraged. I've not called you to live depressed. Why so downcast, oh my soul? Put your hope in God. See, that's what this is all about. Don't cast away your confidence, for it has great reward. See, if you cast away your confidence, there's no reward coming. I don't know about you, but I want my reward. See, we think, well, that's selfish. That's self-serving. No, it's not. Because if God has something for me, I want it. Hello? You say, well, you're a greedy little preacher. Amen. Yes, I am. See, because I know God. I know his character. I know his nature. I know his attributes. And I know that God is good. See, God is not mean. God is not sadistic. God is not looking to punish our lives. God is not looking out to get us and zap us. And that's right. He's not waiting with a 2x4 to knock you over the head when you do something wrong. God has a reward for our lives. But sometimes things can distract us and deter us. You know, I was talking about people saying things. I got a couple examples of people in the natural, okay? These are people who maybe they weren't Christians, maybe they were, I don't know their lives, but, you know, really, just if you look at them at face value, they didn't allow things to get them off of who they were or what they could do. Here was a quote that somebody said about a baseball player. He said, that kid can't play baseball. This was the Milwaukee Braves minor league manager Tommy Holmes in 1952 appraising Hank Aaron, who went on to break Babe Ruth's all-time record for home runs. How about this one? Someone said this, he'll never be any good. That was Baltimore Colts owner Robert Irsay in 1983 evaluating future Pro Bowl and Super Bowl champion quarterback John Elway. I like this one. You will never amount to very much. This was a Munich teacher to a 10-year-old Albert Einstein in 1889. That teacher was eaten their words later on in life. Are you listening? Some of you guys had that spoken over you too. You'll never amount to very much. How about this one? I like this one. Can't act, can't sing, balding, can dance a little. That was an MGM executive in 1929 about Fred Astaire's screen test. Fred Astaire. How about this one? You ain't going nowhere, son. You ought to go back to driving a truck. That was the Grand Ole Opry manager, Jim Denny, in 1954 as he fired Elvis Presley after one performance. He fired the king. How about this? We don't like their sound. Groups of guitars are on their way out. That was Decca Recording Company in 1962 upon turning down the Beatles. Last one for today. I like this one. This is probably my favorite one. Get rid of the pointed ears guy. NBC television executive to Star Trek creator Gene Roddenberry in 1966 recommending the new show eliminate the Vulcan character, Mr. Spock. Ain't no Star Trek without Mr. Spock. Is that right? Now, listen, what's the point? That's all in the natural. That's all with stuff that doesn't matter one bit. Football, baseball, acting, dancing, singing, playing a guitar, playing a part on a show. See, none of that has any consequence eternally. What matters is, as Christians, that we don't allow those distractions, we don't allow those delays, we don't allow those deterrents which come against us on a regular basis to get us to cast away our confidence. If someone ungodly can do that in the natural and become somebody that's world famous, then how much more can God do with a church that will not cast away its confidence, won't get discouraged or depressed, but will go for the reward? See, these people did it for money, for fame, for fortune. We do it because of the eternal reward that's coming our way. The Apostle Paul talked about this in 1 Thessalonians. You want to turn back a couple books in your Bible from Hebrews to 1 Thessalonians. We're going to take a look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse number 2. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse number 2 says this. Paul's writing to the Thessalonians, talking about the mandate God had given him. God had told him, I want you to go and preach the gospel, and you are going to open up the gospel to the Gentile church. Here he inaugurates the dispensation of grace, and he starts preaching and teaching. And he knew that Peter, James, and John, they were sent to the Jews, but he knows that he is sent to the Gentiles. Look at what he says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse number 2. It says, but even after we had suffered before and were spitefully treated at Philippi, as you know. Look at what he says. We were bold in our God to speak to you the gospel of God in much conflict. In other words, the Apostle Paul had the wisdom to recognize and realize that all of these persecutions, all of these trials, even though we were spitefully treated, you know what that is? That's just mean. That's spite. That's I'm trying to hurt you. And even though he knew that people did not have his best interests in mind, in fact, they had his harm in mind, he says, we were still bold in our God. We weren't going to let these distractions or these deterrents to get us off the things of God, to speak to you the gospel of God in much conflict. See, you got to keep what you're wearing. Keep your confidence, church, even through the trial, even through the pressure, even through the pain, even in the midst of persecutions, even in the midst of all the distractions, all the deterrents, even when you want to be discouraged, you want to sit down and quit. God says, don't cast away your confidence. Stay after it. According to Merriam-Webster's dictionary, a reward is to give money or another kind of payment to someone or something for something good that has been done, okay? Now, at this point, I got to make a distinction, all right? Salvation is not a reward, okay? Salvation is a gift that is given to us. Romans chapter 6, verse number 23, for the wages of sin is death, okay? There is a payment that comes from sin called death. But look at this. But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Okay, so your works don't save you. It's not a payment. It's not according to works, but it's according to grace. By grace you've been saved through faith. That is the gift of God, is not of yourselves, lest anyone should boast, right? So salvation is not a reward. Salvation is a gift that is given to us. But our works will be rewarded. We see that in the Bible, okay? A reward comes from our works. Remember our definition, it was a payment rendered for something that was done good. See, sometimes we get this mud in the water where we say, well, am I saved because I'm doing good works? No, you're doing good works because you're saved. Are you listening? They go hand in hand, right? Faith and works. Because you're saved, you do good works, okay? So Matthew chapter 16, verse 27 comes along, and Jesus is speaking, okay? It's red letter in your Bible, if you have the red letter edition. And it says this, for the Son of Man will come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he will reward each according to his salvation. He will reward each according to his faith, his grace, or his what? His works. He will reward each according to his works. So our good works don't buy us salvation. No, faith in what Jesus did on the cross, believing unto righteousness where it produces the works now, shows that I've got a heart for God and now I'm a Christian. It's not by my works of righteousness which I have done that saved me. No, it's according to his mercy. But now, because I have received Jesus, because I am a Christian, now I do good works and my good works will be rewarded. Are you listening today? Now, the original Greek word, okay, this is a simple message, but I'm trying to get it as confusing as possible for you today, okay? The reward of confidence, okay? In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 35, do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward. The old King James version actually has a better translation. It says recompense of reward, okay? In the original Greek, that word for reward is a compound word. There's actually two words, one of them meaning money and another one meaning to give or to recompense, okay? Now, we don't use the word recompense that often, but let me give it to you like this. It's a compensation for the total amount spent of getting a job done. It is a compensation for the total amount spent to get a job done. Let's say everybody in this room, you just became a salesperson, all right? And I'm your boss, and I'm telling you, okay, I want you to go. I want you to travel to a certain city. There's going to be an expo there at the city. I want you to buy a stand. I want you to buy a table, a backdrop. I want you to buy graphics and printing. I want you to buy business cards and literature. I need a trifold pamphlet that you can hand out. And I want you to sell this item that we're selling. And I need you to fly there. I need you to rent a car. I need you to have a hotel room. I need you to stay there. And you're going to need to eat. You're going to need to put gas in the car and that sort of thing. But I don't have an expense card yet that I can hand to you. So you're going to have to take your personal credit card, and you're going to have to go out there and you're going to have to spend your own money to start in order to do all this. But keep your receipts, because when you come back to me after the job is done, I will recompense you. I will pay you back for all that you spent in order to get the job done. And I'm going to give you pay. And if you do a good job, I'll give you a bonus. Right? That's the idea when it comes to our reward. That whatever you spend here on the earth to get the job done, you say, what's the job? Whatever God has called you to do. If God has called you to be a stay-at-home mom, parenting your children there at the house while your spouse is away at work, then you do what it takes. You spend what it should be spent in order to pour into those children's lives and raise them up in the way of the Lord. And at the end, whatever you spent, the Lord will repay and he will reward you according to what you did. Same thing with if you're called to be a carpenter. You do the best job that you can do. You do the best quality work that you can do. You don't cheat on your taxes. You pay your taxes. You pay the people well and you do what you need to do. God will repay you. And he'll bless you. What if God has called you to witness to somebody? Then you go out and you witness in the power of the Holy Spirit. And you do what it needs to be done. And God will recompense you. He will make up for the difference. He'll redeem the time. He'll give you the strength. He'll give you the energy. He'll give you the wisdom. And if you have to spend on the road, on the way, God will take care of your physical and financial needs as well while you're doing the will of God. And then there will be a reward in heaven. Are you listening? Okay, let's take a look at it in the word 2 John. Okay, you're there in Thessalonians. Go towards the back of your Bible now, past Hebrews, past James, past 1 and 2 Peter. You'll find 1 John, then there's 2 John, probably only one page in your Bible. Right past 1 John, there's 2 John. If you hit Revelation or the maps, turn around and come back. You went too far. 2 John, there's only one chapter. We're going to take a look at verse number 8. 2 John, verse 8 says this, look to yourselves, that we do not lose those things we worked for, but that we may receive a full reward. So what is he saying? He's saying, hold on to your receipts. Hello? He's saying, don't lose those things which you worked for. Don't cast away your confidence. You worked hard for it. You endured for it. And just because it's delayed doesn't mean it's not coming. That's not a denial because it's a delay. No, God is faithful. God will add it all up at the end. God will take care of you on the road. He'll take care of you now, and he will take care of you in eternity. God will bring it to pass. Don't cast away your confidence. Don't lose those things which you worked for. Why? That we may receive a full reward. Listen, you lose a receipt, you can't get reimbursed for that thing, right? Why? Because I don't see the receipt. Sometimes we cast away our confidence, we get discouraged, we get depressed, and we say, I guess I'm not going to get healed. Guess I'm not going to get that provision. Guess I'm not going to get that bonus. Guess I'm not going to get the job. Guess my kids are just going to have to go the way of the world. I guess. Listen, you need to stand on the word of the Lord. You need to declare the promise of God. You need to be bold for Jesus. Why? Because that's your confidence. That's your receipts. And if you cast it away, you're not going to get the full reward. Listen, I don't want half a reward. Do you? Oh, no. I don't want 3/4 of my reward. Do you? I don't want 99.9% of my reward. I want a full reward. When I get to heaven, I want God to say, everything I had for you on earth and now in heaven, it's yours. Enter into the joy of your Lord. Why? That's a full reward. Mighty quiet in this place today. See, we've got some receipts. We've got some confidence. We've got some things to hold on to. What do we got? We got the character of God. See, if God was chintzy and cheap and had never blessed me, then I wouldn't have much confidence in the reward, right? Why? Because if he can't take care of me now, I don't know what it's going to be like in the future. But guess what? God's not chintzy. God's not cheap. God has taken care of every need I've ever had. God has overwhelmed me. God has blessed me. God has poured it out so much on me that I just couldn't contain it. It just overflowed from my life to my family to people around me. See, when the cup runneth over, the table gets blessed. Are you listening today? That we may receive a full reward. Let's take a look at it. Talking about our works, okay? Talking about our works. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter number 3. Talking about our works. Talking about as we go before the Father. Talking about a full reward. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. We're going to start in verse number 12. We're going to read through verse number 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse number 12. Look at what it says. It says, now if anyone builds on this foundation, the foundation we find out is Jesus Christ. We build our lives on Jesus Christ. And what we build, that's our works while we're here on the earth. Okay, I'll show this to you in a moment. If anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, precious stones. Stop right there. Everybody say gold, silver, and precious stones.
Gold, silver, and precious stones.
Okay, and then he says wood, hay, and straw. Everybody say wood, hay, and straw. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. Which would you rather have? Gold, silver, and precious stones? Or wood, hay, and straw? Gold, silver, and precious stones, right? Why? Because they're more valuable. Now, it goes on in the next verse. Look at it. It says, verse 13, each one's work will become clear. For the day will declare it. That day is capitalized. That means the day of the Lord, when Jesus comes back. The day will declare it. Because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. Now, again, let me ask you a question. See, it says each one's work will become clear. In other words, the building materials you use to build your life on the foundation of Jesus Christ, that is your works, and your works will become clear for the day will declare it. It will be revealed by fire. Your life is going to go before the throne, and your works will pass in front of God, and fire will come down on your sacrifice, and it will consume it. Now, gold, silver, and precious stones, in the natural, okay, in the physical, when fire hits them, what happens to them? Nothing, right? If anything, they're purified. They come out brighter. They come out sparkling and shiny, right? But what about wood, hay, and straw or stubble? Burns up, right? Consumed. So that means that in your life, when God gives you a mandate, I want you to go and I want you to tell someone about Jesus. You can choose what sort of materials you are going to purchase with your life. You can purchase it with the gold, the silver, the precious stones, or you can go out and you can get wood, hay, and straw. You still got the job done, but you were afraid for some reason to get the other materials. Maybe you thought, well, I can't afford it. I can't spend that type of money. It's my resources. I don't have enough time. I don't have enough energy. I'll get the job done, God. I'll go and tell them, but it's wood, hay, and straw. And yet God is saying, I want you to spend. I want you to purchase the right materials with your life. Why? Because fire is going to test it, and on that day, it will become clear of what sort it is. Now, next verse. Verse 14, if anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a what? Well, that was about a tenth of you guys. A lot more people in the room. He will receive a what?
Reward.
Oh, that was about half. Okay, everybody else, let's get into this. If anyone's work which he built on it endures, if you don't cast away your confidence and you use the right materials and your work endures, he will receive a what?
Reward.
Next verse. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. Remember, salvation is a gift. But your works, if you're not doing the right thing with God, that's going to get burned up before the throne. Church, don't cast away your confidence. If you go out and you say, I know the character of my God, I know the ability of my God, and I'm going to spend and be spent. I'm going to buy the gold, the silver, the precious. What is that? Okay, let's talk for a second. The Bible likens gold to your faith. When you believe God, it says that it's like gold refined in the fire. Well, what about silver? Silver, in the book of Proverbs, you find that the tongue of the righteous is like choice silver. When you declare the word of God, when you tell someone about Jesus, when you speak the right thing out of your mouth, see, the Bible says we will come into judgment for every idle word that we speak. That's going to get burned up before the Father. And yet, if we speak with that tongue of silver, it's like apples of gold in settings of silver. That's your tongue, the tongue of the righteous. What about the precious stones? Paul says, you are our reward. You are our crown. You are our gems. See, the precious stones, as you see the New Jerusalem coming down out of heaven, you'll find that it's made with precious stones all the way around. See, we are being built into a spiritual house, living stones placed together. We are precious stones before the Father. You're going to get to take people with you into eternity. That's what we build our lives with. And as we spend and we are spent, we will receive a reward. Amen. There was a master carpenter who had done a lot of work over his lifetime. Came to the end of his career and back was hurting. He couldn't move as fast as he used to. Eyesight was failing. And he went to his boss and he said, I think I've done my last job. I need to retire. I need to get out of this business. It's just wearing me out. I can't go on anymore. His boss said, I'll let you do that, but I need you for one more job. I need you to build one more house. Man says, no, I'm hurting, my eyesight is failing, and I can't do any more for you. I just need to be done. He says, please, would you help me out? I just need you for one more job. I need to go find someone else. Would you at least do me the courtesy? Do this last job for me, and then I'll let you retire. He says, fine, okay, I guess I'll do it. Now the boss comes out with a stack of plans, and he opens it up in front of this master carpenter. And the master carpenter, as he's looking over these plans, man, he sees, well, we did this kitchen on this job. I really like that kitchen. So he's looking at the outside, at the elevations. He says, you know what? This was the type of house that I know I told him I like this. It's like he took all of my best ideas and he put it into one house, and now he's wanting me to build this as my last job? What's that all about? And so his heart kind of gets discouraged. He kind of gets angry about it. He's a little bitter. And so he rushes through the job. He buys the cheapest materials he can find. He goes quickly. He doesn't do the best work. Things aren't lined up and plumb and all that. And he just rushes the job. He's hurting. He's just done. And so he builds this house. And he finishes the house off. And he comes back to his boss and he says, here's the keys. I'm done. I just can't do this anymore. I'm not in this anymore. I need to retire. And the boss says, thank you so much for finishing this last house for me. I've got everything under control on the back. Here's your last paycheck. And I've got a bonus for you. Here are the keys to your new house that you just built. Now, some of you guys are clapping, but you don't realize what he just built, he now received. In our lives, what we build into eternity, we will receive. That's why it's so important that we build the way God would have us to build, to do what God would have us to do, to not cast away your confidence, for it has great reward. And our reward, it goes far beyond gold, silver, and precious stones. Genesis, the 15th chapter, let me close with this. Talk about a reward. Genesis, the 15th chapter, verse number 1. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your exceedingly great reward. When we go to heaven, I'm not looking for gold. The streets are lined with it. I don't care. That's asphalt. That's under my feet. It's what we walk around on. I'm not looking for silver. The Bible says that in Solomon's day, silver was like the stones. They just scattered it everywhere. I'm not looking for precious stones, even though I want to see people in heaven. That's great, and that's a call that's on our life, and that's why we preach the way we do. That's why we pastor the way we do. That's why we give altar calls in this church, is because we want to see heaven filled up. But when I get to heaven, all of that is wonderful, and all of that is needed, but my reward is not in those things. My reward is God himself receiving me into his arms and saying, well done, my child. Enter into the joy of your Lord. Are you listening today? Come on, did you guys get something from the Word? Let's give God a great big praise. Hallelujah. I want to talk to you before you go. Let me love you enough to yell at you. You're in the street, there's a car coming, and I don't want you to get hit by it. I want to ask you a question. I want you to answer the question in your heart. No one will know the answer but you and God. Here's the question. What if today was your last day on the earth? You died. God forbid that should happen to anybody in this room, but what if? We're not assured tomorrow. Jesus could come back. But what if this was your last day on the earth? Would you go to heaven? Or would you go to hell? Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I don't believe in hell. I believe that hell is a fairy tale made up by parents to scare their children into being good. But the problem with that thinking is that the Bible talks about hell. This is not an idea of man. This is an idea of God. God talks about it Old and New Testament. In fact, Jesus himself spoke of hell. So it's a very real place. And just by ignoring its existence doesn't make it go away. You're going to have to face the reality of it. And will you let this pastor love you enough to tell you the truth, to get out of the street? There's a car coming. I'm going to make sure that you don't get hit by hell. You say, Pastor, well, I don't have to worry about that. All roads lead to heaven. And you do your thing, I'll do my thing. The churches out there and the religions, they can do their thing. And, you know, we'll all get there somehow, some way. But the problem with that thinking is that Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. What does that mean? That means it's God's heaven going to have to get there God's way. Can't get there your way. Can't get there my way. Can't get there some well-meaning church committee's way. Got to get there God's way. Don't you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son Jesus, beaten bloody and hung on a cross. Don't you think after doing all that, he would tell us how to get to heaven? Well, he does in his word, the Bible. Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, that's good news because I've been a good person. I know that God lets good people into heaven. You know, my good really outweighs my bad. Used to be bad, clean up my act, now I'm good. And doesn't that mean that God notices that and sees that, appreciates that, and will let me into heaven? Well, the problem with that thinking is that, did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say you can be good enough to get to heaven? Because the standard is perfection. The only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. We talked about this. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And the wages of sin is death. Not going to make it to heaven based on your good works. You can't work your way in to the kingdom of God. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, I get that. I understand that. But I was raised in church. Parents told me we were Christians growing up. Born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindus. We're Christians. Went to religious classes growing up. Sunday school. Catechism class, Sabbath school class. They hung a cross or St. Christopher on your neck, had you baptized or christened as a child. Now, while that's great, and I'm glad you did those things, could you just show that to me in the Bible where that gets you into heaven? Your religious upbringing, parents tell you're Christian, that makes you a Christian. Can you show me in the Bible where you attend religious classes, wear religious jewelry, or be baptized or christened as a child, and you get to go to heaven? It's not there. And nowhere, check it out, nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're not some other religion and that because you're born in America, that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. You say, Pastor, I understand that, but not only when I was a child did I go to church, here I am sitting in church right now. Doesn't that make me a Christian? Well, that's like saying I could go to my garage at my house, sit in my garage, call myself a car, and that makes me a car. Doesn't matter how long I sit there, even if I make car noises, I will never become a car. In the same way, you can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. You say, Pastor, I get that. I understand that. But you don't understand. My last church, I got involved. I helped out, sang in the choir, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader, even got a membership card to that church. Now, while that's great, I'm glad you did those things. Just show that to me in the Bible where your volunteerism in church helps you to get into heaven. It doesn't work like that. We're back to good works now, aren't we? Can't do enough good, volunteer enough in church, help out, carry the pastor's Bible, make decisions, sing in the choir. Can't do it. Not going to make it. God is not looking for your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. Now, sometimes people say, I understand all that. I got you on this one, though, Pastor. Someone told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I know God. I know about Jesus. Celebrate Easter and the resurrection. Sing the songs of Christmas every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. Now, while that's great, I'm glad you can do all those things. Just show that to me in the Bible where they get you into heaven. In fact, if you'd read your Bible, you'd know the demons believe that Jesus Christ is Son of God. They're not Christians. If you'd read your Bible, you know the devil himself knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So everybody look up at me for a second. Look up here. It's not about what you have in your head that counts. It's not about having mental assent towards God, having head knowledge about who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God, but rather this is about your heart. Jesus said it like this. He said, you must be born again. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that term. They've raked it to the coals. But let's not let Hollywood movies, television, and the internet describe for us what being born again means. Let's let the Bible do that for us. What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. It's that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you in the book of Revelation, last book in the Bible. Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot, or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what is he saying, lukewarm? What's that all about? Well, it's a little in, a little out, a little up, a little down, a little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today, I'm going to give you an opportunity. Jesus said, you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father in heaven. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So today, your call, your choice. I'm going to count to three, just like this. One, two, three. When I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together, just like that. Bang! That's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. You say, whoa, wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. You might be. Let's push past that today, because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever? And no one make that trade. And yet the devil thinks that you're dumb and going to try and talk you out of it right now. Listen, tell that devil, go jump in a fiery lake. You're going on with God. Get ready to get your hand up. We've all done this. No one's judging you, laughing at you, criticizing you, or condemning you. We're excited for you today. You're in a safe and friendly place where you can give God all of your heart, give God all of your life. Who should raise their hand in a moment if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today is your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus? Come on. Get ready to get your hand up. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm in this place? You know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. You can make a right relationship with God simply acknowledging your need for Jesus, lifting your hands in this place. All across the auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer or in the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put the burger down, get ready to get your hand up, and then you can tell an usher right afterwards or come into the church service. Online, you want to give God your heart and your life? Hey, get ready to get your hand up. God's watching. God sees. And then you can click the blue button that says respond to God or go to our homepage at rockchurch.com. And how to know God, click that button. Someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. Thank you. There's one, two, three, four, five. Thank you. There's six. Thank you. Who else today? Up on top, give me a little wave. A little wave up on top. There's six. Anybody else real quick? All right. Seven. Thank you. Eight. Got you over there. Nine, 10, 11 in the family room. 12 in the family room. Got you over there. Who else today? 12. Come on. If that's you, just raise it up high for me. 12. On this side, where are you at? 12. Where are you at back there? 13. Got you. Thank you for waving at me. Had a little trouble seeing you. 14. God bless you over there. God bless you. Who else today? 14. Wise people already. 15 up top. Got you. God bless you. On this side. 15, 16. Thank you. 17. Got you up there. Thank you. Anybody else real quick? 18 up there. Got you right there. Thank you. God bless you. About 18 wise people. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? There's 18 wise people already. Anybody else real quick? 18, 19 up top. Got you over there. Thank you. 19. Oh, don't you just feel 20? Number 20. Got you right there. Come on. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. 20 wise people. Hallelujah. God is so good. Now listen, all 20 of you, or the Spirit of God just spoke to me. Listen, if God can speak to me about pains in people's bodies, the Word of God to deliver that to you, He can speak to me about the condition of your life. There's five more of you that didn't raise your hand, but you should have. It's not too late. Here's what I want you to do. While we're all going to stand, we're all going to give a clap and a shout. As we do, that's your cue. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand but didn't, here's what I want you to do. Get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. I want you to get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies today. Can't do that until we get you down here. So if that's you, you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Get your stuff. Get a friend if you need a friend. Get in the aisle and meet me up front. You come right now. Come on, let's welcome them as they come. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation.
I surrender.
They're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come.
Come to thee, my
you You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment. From the family rooms, you can bring your children. They'll remember this. Come on down. Come on down. They're still coming. Come on. You can come too. You can come too.
I surrender.
Hallelujah. They're still coming. There's room for you. There's room for you. Just get in the aisle. Meet me up front right now. Come on, come on, come on.
Blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Hallelujah. They're still coming. Will you allow me? Will you allow me a couple more minutes? Listen, not everybody that raised their hand is up here. You don't get saved by raising your hand. I love you enough to tell you the truth. Listen, you're still in the street. You heard the word and you responded, but you didn't get out. Okay? I want to make sure that you're right with God. And you got to give God all your heart, got to give God all your life. You do that when you pray and invite Jesus in your heart. He's a gentleman. He won't just take over. He's a gentleman and he wants you to invite him in. And then he'll come in and make you brand new. Okay? I want that for your life. So I'm going to have Elijah sing this one more time. And if you raised your hand or you didn't raise your hand, but you should have, this is your time. This is your cue. Come on, God's tugging at your heart. Just make your way to the front right now. Go ahead and sing that, Elijah. Will you come right now? Just make your way to the front. Come on down.
And I surrender.
No, you need to do this.
All.
Hallelujah, they're coming.
I surrender.
Anybody else?
All.
Come on, just make your way to the front right now.
Unto thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender.
Hallelujah. Well, if you need to come while I'm giving instructions, you can just make your way to the front right now. Hey, guys up front, praise God you came. So excited for your new life in Jesus Christ. I want to introduce you guys to a friend of mine right over here to my right, your left. This is Pastor Joel waving at you. Real good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. He's going to pray with you, give you some free information, some free literature to find out what to do next in your walk with God. Then he's going to introduce you to a friend we have here in the church that we like to call a spiritual personal trainer. Heard of a physical trainer at the gym, helps you get strong. Spiritual personal trainer will do that for you spiritually so you don't go back to your old ways, but you go on with God for the rest of your days, all right? Now, let me make a promise to you guys. Give us a year of your life here at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, sitting under the teaching consistently, okay? We have 11 church services a week. Get into as many of those as you can. 1, 2, hey, why not be radical? 3, 4, okay? Consistently for 1 year. At the end of that year and for the rest of your life, you will look around and say, man, I did not know I could be this blessed. Am I telling the truth, everybody? All right, take their word for it. If you guys are making a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give them a hand as they go. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.